Welcome, folk, as we come together at the end of another Lord's Day to share together. Just to note that I am recording this quite intentionally. We're into the spectre of load shedding a little bit more regularly. And I see our esteemed power utility has extended stage two for the next week. So I'm aware that some folk may well be struggling to connect this evening. And along with that, we've got one or two of our elderly folk and others who are just data compromised, who just Zoom just chows up all pretty much all of their available stuff. So it's easier for them after the fact to connect to YouTube and actually listen. So the intention with this isn't to watch movies. I mean, the point is I'd love everyone to be together on this platform so that we can at least enjoy some virtual fellowship. But I am aware of some of the data constraints, and therefore the recording after the fact is helpful for a few. But with that in mind, folks, let's pray, and then I will dive into where I want to go this evening, and then we can hopefully get to a time of prayer as well at the end as well. Father, we thank you again just for the opportunity at the end of another Lord's Day to gather together, even on this virtual platform, and to be able to share and to learn and to interact. And so, Father, we do pray that through the power of your Spirit, you would just teach us, instruct us, cause our awareness of truth to just be expanded, our love for Jesus to be warmed, and Father, through that our Christian lives might be better enriched, just knowing more about the Savior. And Lord, our last little series was about growing in the grace and knowledge of Christ. So cause this to just to be a good follow on from that. So achieve your purposes in our lives as we share together this evening, we pray. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Well, folks, I mentioned this morning, apologies to any of the oaks that are on this platform. I know we dealt with Christ as mediator a few weeks ago as we went through R.C. Sproul's volume, Essential Truths of the Christian Faith, and immediately followed that up with the three offices of Christ. But you can blame Bruce for this particular series when I asked the elders for ideas just in terms of rounding off the year to fill these 3 weeks in November before the missions focus. Bruce suggested we look at the three offices of Christ, which is what I've taken hold of. So I trust it'll be helpful. It is such an incredibly rich study that I doubt we're going to do justice to it in just the limited amount of time available. But I am going to move quickly and trust that if anything, that would at least stimulate your thinking, maybe for even more and broader reading on this particular issue. So I've entitled this Christ, One Mediator, Three Offices. And just to put you in the loop right up front, the offices that we're referring to are the roles of prophet, priest, and king. So what I'm going to do this evening at very, very high speed is just lay a foundation for that and then dive into the issue of prophet. And then we'll have a little bit more time to explore the priesthood and the kingship of the Lord Jesus Christ as well. All right, with that out of the way of introduction and preface, let's dive in. If I were to throw the concept of a mediator at you and ask you for a definition, I think we'd all be able to hammer out a reasonably good working definition of what a mediator actually is. Mediators are often seen in conflict cases. You know, for example, in the workspace, there might be conflict between an employer and an employee, and there needs to be a settlement, and they go to the CCMA, and the CCMA appoint a mediator or functions as the mediator between two parties that are estranged on a particular issue. We see it even in the marriage space. Mediation is called for, maybe a counselor, a pastor, a psychologist, whatever the case might be, to referee, to be the impartial go-between, to be the bridge. And sometimes even the courts might ask a couple who are pursuing divorce to just put the brakes on that and go for mediation to see if the relationship can be restored before they kind of rush headlong to the high court with the attorneys to actually dissolve that relationship. So it's in most cases where there is a tension and where there is a conflict, where there needs to be a bridging and a reconciling. Well, folks, we need that spiritually as well. I think it's true as we look through scripture, on account of sin, we as sinful people are alienated from God and we are cut off from fellowship with him. For example, in Isaiah 59, verse 2, we read, "But your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear." In Romans chapter 5, we're described as enemies of God. Paul writes in Romans chapter 8 that the flesh of the unsaved is hostile to God. Paul picks up on that in the passage in Ephesians 2, where he says that you were dead in your trespasses and sins. And just a little bit after that, he talks about being dead and damned and disobedient. In Ephesians chapter 4, he describes the unbeliever as darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. So whether we look at it through an Old Testament lens or a New Testament lens, it doesn't matter. People are alienated from God, cut off from fellowship, and we're not in a relationship with him. However, God steps in. We can't bridge that gap on our own. We know that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. There's nothing that we can do to, in a sense, bridge that gap. But through Jesus Christ, his person and his work, God reconciles the world to himself, and God breaks down those barriers of hostility and estrangement and distance and separation. For example, if we go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 18, we read those precious words, "All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation." In Romans chapter 5, verse 6, we read, "For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly." So the point is, God in his redemptive plan reaches into that chasm that divides us, and through the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, he provides the grounds for reconciliation to happen, for that barrier to be broken down and the hostility to end and the war to be over. It's a wonderful, wonderful picture when we consider that reconciling work. But folk, that is not something that just pops up onto the New Testament radar screen. As we look back into the Old Testament, there are shadowy pictures of reconcilers, of mediators. There were mediators in the system of God long before Christ that pointed towards what was to come in Christ. And I just want to run through those very, very briefly this evening. If I can just find where I want to be, that would... Hold on, pause. There we go. All right, you should be able to see in a moment or two a picture on your screen with the three offices of mediation. And effectively, if I just run through them with this picture up to understand, we've got the office of prophet and the priest and king in Old Testament Israel. And the Old Testament prophet was a mediator in a downward direction. The prophet spoke from God downwards. God revealed truth through the prophet to the people. It was a downward mediation. The prophet effectively was God's spokesman. He was God's ambassador. He was the one who was the revealer of truth. The prophet would get revelation from God in a variety of different ways and come to the people and say, "Thus saith the Lord." It didn't come directly to people. It was always mediated through a prophet. So that's the first office that we want to consider in terms of Old Testament history. The second office that we have a look at is the office of priest. And this is an upward mediation. That's somebody that stood in the gap between the people and God. The priest would offer sacrifices to God on behalf of the people. The priest would offer prayers and intercessions on behalf of the people to God. It was the priest that, in a sense, stood in the gap, to use the language of Ezekiel, mediating in that way. But it was an upward way. The third office that we have a look at is that of king. God's authority, God's kingship was mediated through a king to the people of God. We know, and you would have heard me refer to it even this morning, that Israel was to be a theocracy, not a monarchy. God was always the ultimate king. He's the one on his throne. You know, he's the one who is high and exalted above absolutely everything, the circle of the earth. We worship at his footstool. But that authority was mediated to the people through the kings of Israel that the Lord actually set up, from Saul and David and Solomon and so forth. So just keep that at the back of your minds, even as we go through the next couple of weeks, that everything that we're looking at about Christ was rooted in these shadowy pictures of prophet, priest, and king in terms of Old Testament Israel's history and the whole system of mediation that the Lord entrenched. However, Jesus Christ burst onto the scene, and we know that he came as the mediator, the only true mediator. And the Apostle Paul nails that stake into the ground so clearly as he writes in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5 and 6, "For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time." That was Christ's ultimate role, to mediate between a holy God and unholy people, a righteous God and unrighteous people. And through his work, his perfect life, where he racked up perfect righteousness, through his suffering, through his death, through his resurrection, all of that accomplished that mediating, reconciling role. Now, interestingly, and I just want to throw it into the mix, when we were chatting about this at Oaks of Righteousness, our men's group, a couple of weeks ago, Chris made the point quite validly that in a sense, it's a one-sided mediation. It's true. In typical mediation, there's negotiation and there's compromise and there's give and there's take, etc. But that doesn't happen in Christ's role of mediation with us, because God doesn't budge. God's holiness and his righteousness and his rules and his standards and his precepts and his glory remain the unchanging standard. The bridging that happens with us isn't that God is brought closer to us and we're brought a bit closer to God and we hammer out an agreement of how we can kind of play happy families with the creator and king of the universe. It doesn't work that way. God's standards remain absolutely true and unchanging. Christ brings us close. And through his finished work, we are regarded as acceptable. We're regarded as righteous before God. But God doesn't change in any way through this mediating role that the Lord Jesus Christ accomplished. But it is just so precious to just consider how we see that in the New Testament. For example, Paul writes in Colossians chapter 1, picking up in verse 19, "For in him, in Christ, all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross." And he goes on to say, "And you, who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds," in other words, we're far removed from God, "he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you as holy and blameless and above reproach before him." That's what Christ does as the reconciler, as the mediator. He takes those that were alienated and enemies and hostile and doing evil deeds, and we're brought into a place where we are regarded as holy and blameless and acceptable before the Lord. Which makes perfect sense of that precious verse in Romans 5 verse 1. "Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." Christ has done it all, and we rest on his finished work and his righteousness in that way. But folk, when we come to the issue of mediator, we need to understand that it is much broader than just the issue of reconciliation. To be sure, it certainly covers the issue of reconciliation, but Christ's role as mediator is much, much broader than just the fact that Christ bridges the gap and reconciles us to a holy God. Because it was Reformation Sunday last week, I can't resist. And in fact, for this series, I can't, in fact, get by without drawing our attention from time to time to John Calvin. And if I do that this evening again, just to go to my screen and make sure that that's visible for you. Sorry. Can you see Calvin? Hopefully you can see Calvin. He says this in Institutes 2, Book 15 and Subsection 1. "Therefore, that faith may find in Christ a solid ground of salvation and so rest in him, we must set out with this principle that the office which he received from the Father consists of three parts. For he was appointed both prophet, king, and priest, though little were gained by holding the names unaccompanied by knowledge of the end and use." Just have a look. I know it's in difficult language, and this is a translation even from the original French. But the point that he's making in that last sentence is this: Christ is appointed as prophet, priest, and king by the Father. But if we just know him as prophet, priest, and king without an understanding of what that actually means and what is consists within those great titles, it actually avails very little benefit for us at all. So my intention with this series is not just so that you know that Christ was prophet, priest, and king. If we want to heed Calvin, that we need to not hold to the names in a way that is unaccompanied by knowledge of the end and the use of that. So I trust that that would be helpful as we go through those particular issues. So folks, that's effectively what we're going to do. It's going to be short. It's going to be hopefully sweet. It is going to be high speed, but we're going to touch on Christ's role as mediator beyond just the reconciling issue and see his fulfillment of this mediating role as he functions as prophet, and as he functions as priest, and as he functions as king. And I use the term fulfill deliberately, because in the Old Testament, the mediating offices of prophet, priest, and king were held by separate individuals. You'd have a prophet, you'd have Isaiah or Jeremiah or Ezekiel, etc. And then you'd have the priesthood, and then you'd have the kings, but they weren't the same people. But in the Lord Jesus Christ, he fulfills all of those offices in himself perfectly, in his own person. And that's what makes him particularly remarkable and unique and unmatched in a particular way. All right. So with that, by way of introduction, just to the issue of mediator and the roles of prophet, priest, and king, let's consider then this evening, first of all, the Lord Jesus Christ as prophet. Again, if I remind you of the picture that I showed you, the Old Testament prophet was a downward mediation. The prophet was God's spokesman. He was the revealer of truth. And interestingly, many, many, many of the Old Testament prophets spoke of Christ, either directly or in a veiled, shadowy way. I mean, there is clear evidence of messianic expectation in the prophetic writings as they were looking forward to the coming of the Anointed One. And in fact, looking back, Jesus himself refers to that as we go to that wonderful chapter of after the resurrection on the road to Emmaus with those two disciples, and we don't know who they were. And twice in that episode, Jesus interacts with them and he refers back and he says that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. And then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And the point is embedded in the very fabric. I think the old term was warp and woof, if I'm not mistaken. And the very fabric of the Old Testament is Christ. And there's just a clear set of evidences that points towards him. So Jesus came and he fulfilled all of those prophecies. That's true. But the staggering thing is, he also came as a prophet. He didn't just come to fulfill the prophecies, but he actually came as a prophet. And the guys that were with us on at Oaks a few weeks ago will recognize this. I just want to go back to my PowerPoint for a moment, if I can get it to work. R.C. Sproul, in that book that we're working through, Essential Truths of the Christian Faith, says the following, quote, "As the prophet of God par excellence, Jesus was both the object and the subject of prophecy. His person and his work are the focal point of Old Testament prophecy, yet he himself was a prophet." That's an interesting statement that Sproul makes, because there's no greater prophet than the Lord Jesus Christ. But it's interesting how he nails down that he's both the object of and the subject of. And everything that he did in terms of his personhood and his work, the Old Testament was pointing towards. And yet when the Lord Jesus Christ came and was born and lived and died, he actually did so as a prophet as well. So it wasn't just looking forward towards him, but everything that he did actually fulfilled that as well. Which begs the question then for us this evening, how exactly was Jesus a prophet? And I just want to run through that very, very briefly. Sorry, let me hydrate quickly. I shouted at you for about 48 minutes this morning, so my throat is still recovering from that. How was Jesus a prophet? Well, first and foremost, he was prophesied to come as a prophet. The Messiah as a prophet was actually built into the Old Testament prophecy. When I read these verses from Isaiah chapter 61, you'll see how, and they're well known. This is clearly messianic. "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to those who are bound." Jesus was anticipated as a prophet, as the bringer of good news, as the one who would be proclaiming liberty and would be proclaiming the opening of the prison to those who were bound spiritually. So that's just one example. And I just want you to see that there's a very strong sense of the Messiah coming in his role, in a role as a prophet. And so when Jesus burst onto the scene, some of the people, not all of them to be sure, but some of the people started to join the dots. The Lord Jesus Christ was acclaimed as a prophet by those who witnessed his miracles and certainly by those who heard his teaching. They recognized in the ministry of Jesus Christ that he was a bearer of the word of God. When he came and he spoke with authority, concerning the nature of God, the purposes of God, the kingdom of God, they recognized that he was different, very, very different from everything that they'd heard around him. Again, if we go back to Calvin for a moment, I'm not going to share the text, just quite simply, because I don't have a slide for it. But Calvin noted as well, quote, "We see that he was anointed by the Spirit to be a herald and a witness of his Father's grace, and not in the usual way. For he is distinguished from other teachers who had a similar office." Calvin's onto something there. When you look at the Lord Jesus Christ, he didn't just come as a prophet, but in the words of Sproul, he was a prophet par excellence. There was no one like him. And even John the Baptist recognized him in that way. He knew that Jesus was greater than himself, who himself was a prophet. And we read in John chapter 1, verse 15, John bore witness about him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks before me because he was before me." John himself realizes that the Lord Jesus Christ is far, far superior to him in terms of his prophetic ministry. And when people saw the signs that he did and heard his preaching, they realized that he was different. John chapter 6, verse 14, when the people saw the sign that he had done, they said, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." They're looking at Christ and going, "Can't be anyone but him." And that was affirmed by many, many different people. Again, if we keep in John's gospel for the moment, the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are" what? "A prophet." Because of the interaction that she had had with him. Right at the end of Jesus' life, when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." And just after that, we read in Matthew 21, although they were seeking to arrest him, they feared the crowds because they held him to be a prophet. So even the common people, certainly by the tail end of Jesus' life, had recognized that he was a prophet of significant merit. And we can certainly see that, folk, even from our own reading through Scripture. If we go back, for example, to the Sermon on the Mount, where we were for a good chunk of last year into this year, the Lord Jesus Christ pronounces blessings with authority. Blessed are those who is functioning as a prophet. When he calls down curses, he does so with authority. He's saying, "Woe is you." He's not just saying, "Thus saith the Lord, woe is you." He himself is saying, "Woe is you" to the Pharisees. And you can read through, I think it's Matthew 23. It's over and over and over and over again how the Lord exercises that authority. And the Lord himself affirms that his words carry authority because his words are from God. Mm-hmm. In John 7:16, Jesus answered them, "My teaching is not mine, but his who sent me." In other words, he is mediating God's word, although he himself is God, in his prophetic role, bringing truth to people. And the intriguing thing is, it's what we touched on Friday with the men as well, that Christ is the Word incarnate. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was with Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. He didn't just bring the Word, he was the Word of God himself. And so when Jesus spoke, folk, we need to realize that it was God speaking. Christ, as the second person of the Trinity, co-equal with the Father in power and glory, when he opened his mouth and he spoke and he talked, he was carrying the authority of God because he was God. And we can see that, for example, in Hebrews chapter 1, in just the first couple of verses, long ago and at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets, but in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed as heir of all things, through whom he also created the world. And then the writer of Hebrews goes on to extol the sonship of the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. And he upholds the universe by the word of his power. And after making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name that he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. The point is, he spoke by that Son. And as truth was given, we can certainly see that Jesus was not just a good teacher. He was not just a communicator of truth from God to people. He wasn't just functioning as a mouthpiece for God. When Jesus spoke, he was speaking divine truth directly. Sure, we know he spoke with power. He spoke with grace. The words that he brought brought untold blessing to people. The words that he spoke carried warning in terms of judgment and rebuke as well that needed to be heeded. As prophet, Jesus pointed people towards the kingdom where he himself would rule as king. He commanded people and in fact invited people to respond to the words of life that he brought that would offer them forgiveness and hope and joy and victory forever. Prophetic ministry, not just taking God's truth to people, but actually speaking directly in those ways. And so, folks, we need to just realize that this evening, that he is our mediator because he is our prophet. And as we just consider the life of the Lord Jesus Christ and his ministry and his teaching and so forth, I think we need to just grasp onto those wonderful truths and reflect on them. So that is pretty much where, as far as I wanted to get this evening, just laying foundation for us. And then having a look at Christ's prophetic role. And then, God willing, next week, we will pick up on the next office and look at that specifically. We'll have a bit more time to delve into that, a bit more detail, and that is Christ as priest. But, folks, we come to a time of prayer. And just before I end the recording, just to give us some direction, we've got about 12 minutes. I'll take about 2 minutes just to work through this. I want to just put up some prayer pointers for this evening, if I can. There, and there. Great. That should be visible to you. Just in light of where we've been this evening, I just want to give a little bit of directionality to our prayer time. And let's do it this way. Let's pray, being prayer even this evening for our people at the Randburg Baptist Church. And I think let's pray for our community as well. Mm-hmm. We need to be praying for believers to be built up, but we need to be praying for the lost around us to come to a saving faith in Christ. But let's pray particularly that they would be amazed at the words of Jesus, be blown away with the truth of the good news. You know, the gospel comes to both save sinners and to sanctify and to strengthen the saints. Mm. So let's, you know, as we're reading the words of Jesus Christ and, in fact, the full revelation of God, pray that indeed we would be struck by that. Pray that our people in our community would hear him offer life and forgiveness and freedom and hope through what he accomplished, through his death and his resurrection. And not just have the ears tickled by that, but respond to those words with amazement and with also with joyful obedience, to indeed trust in him and to believe in him. Thirdly, pray that our people and our community would humbly receive the word of God and love it and read it and meditate on it. And that we would indeed, as a community of faith at Randburg, just be ever increasing in our appreciation of the word of God as mediated through Christ. And lastly, picking up with the words of James, that we wouldn't just be hearers of the word, but be doers. And that where Christ offers calls and commands and instructions and imperatives and invitations, that we would respond to what he has said in those ways. So, look, I'm going to put that up again as we come to a time of prayer. But I trust that was helpful and enriching. And then, God willing, we'll pick up on that next week. So I'm going to just stop the recording.